Glory to the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father Seraphim was born and raised in Romania. He was tonsured and ordained as priest at a monastery in northern Moldavia. He studied international economic relations in Bucharest and Moscow, followed by a MA at the Department of English and Comparative Literary Studies, University of Warwick, United Kingdom. After he joined his monastery in the year 2004, he obtained his second BA in Orthodox Theology from the University of Bucharest. Between 2009 and 2013, he was a doctoral student at Durham University, United Kingdom, under the supervision of the Reverend Professor Andrew Louth. Is that right, Louth?
Louth.
Louth. His PhD thesis is focused on Archimandrite Soproni Sakharov's ecclesiology. After the completion of his PhD, Father Seraphim was awarded a three-year postdoctoral research position at the University of Oxford, due to begin in January of 2015. For the last few years, Father Seraphim has worked to establish a monastery on the Isle of Mull, that's M-U-L-L, Hebrides, Scotland. This will be the first Orthodox monastery in these Celtic Isles in over a millennium, and will mark the return of Orthodox monasticism at the very heart of the ancient Celtic Church. In the year 2010, Father Seraphim acquired the Church of Saints Cuthbert and Ninian, which was built in 1755, on the foundation of a 7th century monastic dwelling. After 1 year of fundraising in the United States and the United Kingdom, he has also raised the money to buy 5 acres of land surrounding the church. He is now back in the United States looking for funds to build a small house for the future monastics so that the monastery may begin its proper existence. This will be an English-speaking monastery dedicated to all Celtic saints. And his website is www.mull, that's M-U-L-L, monastery.com. So we're very honored to have Father Seraphim. He's already spoken to our church and to some of the other neighboring Orthodox churches as well, and it's been his presentations have been very well received.
Thank you, Father. All right. Now we are out of the church. So we don't have a building around us. There's no setting, there's no framework. So let's try to ignore that bad guy over there with the camera. And just try to be just honest and personal somehow, because otherwise it will just turn into me giving you a lecture, and I don't believe in lectures. I've never met anybody who lectured me and then changed my life. I've only met people who I've met privately and have spoken to me with all their hearts, and those people sometimes do change my lives. And very often they have to speak for an hour so that, you know, 3 minutes of what they say actually touch me. So keep me talking. I need your help with that. Why I agreed to this thing about recording, and because I've learned by now never to say no. I don't know, if people ask me to do things and I'm here to do things for the monastery, I will say yes, even if when I say it, I'm already wondering how am I going to go through that. I say yes because if God put it in my way, there must be a reason. So, we're supposed to talk about monasticism and the monastic life And I assume you could hardly find anybody less appropriate than myself to do it. But, you know, again, if I was asked, I said yes. So I'll just do my best. I try to never prepare, except when I'm really panicked. And this is the proof. I am really panicked. This is what I'm supposed to, you know, say in, I don't know, 10 minutes. It's less than one page. So, yeah, it's called a calling, the first idea. The second, a vision of myself. And then a third, a vision of what monasticism is. People very often, especially in America, ask me, how do you know that you are supposed to be a monk? How do you know that you are supposed to go and live in a women's monastery? And the truth is that you don't. You don't know anything for sure, because if you knew for sure, then it wouldn't be a sacrifice. It wouldn't be an act of faith. It wouldn't be an answer to a calling. I mean, don't look for a perfect recipe, a list of things you can check in your own hearts. And then if you tick all of them off, you know you are monastic material. You won't get that. You won't ever get that. I've never met anybody who knew for sure that, you know, I'm going to become a saint by doing this. There's no guarantee. But if you really listen to your heart at the same time, and if you are deeply honest about what you hear in your heart, you will know that you have a calling for it. A calling to which you might answer, or you might just ignore. And also a calling which you might answer at the right time, or too early, or sometimes very late. So that's the first thing I would say. Be very honest to yourself. Be very honest when you pray. I go back to that. We talked about prayer last night. I think the moment of prayer, those few minutes or hours or whatever, it doesn't matter how long it takes, but those moments of prayer is when who you really are is actually born. And if you jump those, or if you rush through them, or if you just don't do your prayer one day, you're basically not allowing yourself to be born. You're not allowing yourself to find out who you are supposed to be. I mean, I know myself, when I sit and I pray, I very often think, oh, this is really going well. I mean, this is really going well. I mean, where's the light? And then you realize it's not that well, because you are aware of what you're doing, and because you are aware it's supposed to be well. It's good prayer. And in many ways, it's rather than an apophatic way of doing theology, an apophatic way of living your life. You build your prayer, you build yourself up in prayer, and then God gives you one fraction of a second when you realize that you're faking it all. And then you have to take down that idol that you've created in your own heart about yourself and start doing it again. And it is extremely humbling, it is extremely frustrating, and it takes a lot of time. But if you don't do it, you'll end up building an idol. You'll build up thinking that you are something that you aren't, actually. So this fight for honesty, some people would call it being authentic in your prayer. This is essential. If you manage to have 1 second, I won't even say 1 moment, of being completely blank, honest, naked in front of God every day, every night, then you will know what your path is supposed to be, if you are meant to be a monastic or not. Sometimes, I remember in England, someone asked me, I kept going back to this expression of nakedness, of being naked, because that's how I felt. I feel exposed in those moments. I feel that God sees things I would really like him not to see, although, you know, theoretically I do pray that he heals everything in me, and actually I get to see things of myself that I would like very much to just bury and ignore that they are there. And I realized that this, as an answer to this question about nakedness, that I actually see a very clear parallel between a soul's encounter with Christ and the way, you know, a husband and a wife meet in their wedding night, on their wedding night. I'm now trying to be as honest about everything as I can, but I remain aware that you are here and that you will go and, you know, mind your own lives and take what I say and say it further. I'm also aware of that camera. I'm also aware that I don't have any control of what's going to happen with this recording. So despite my attempts to be honest, there is a mask. I might talk to only two or three of you, and I'm doing my best to be honest, but I'm aware that I'm a monastic. I'm aware I am a priest. I'm aware I represent the Orthodox faith. I'm aware I'm perhaps one of the very few monastics you will meet this year. So again, in spite of my best intentions to be completely honest, I have a mask. And this happens with everyone. Even if you interact with your best friend or your, you know, the people you meet in your offices or people in the church or in the street, we always carry a mask. And very often, I would say always, we have a mask when we look into the mirror as well. We like to see things about ourselves, or at least to think things about ourselves, and ignore the rest. Well, when you sit down and you kneel and you pray, that's when the only aim should be to get rid of all the masks, to be completely naked. Just the way, again, on a wedding night, a man and a woman, for the first time, they see themselves completely naked in all their weaknesses and most intimate fears and complexes. And so there is a parallel there. Christ should see my soul and should meet my soul the way those two people will meet for the first time on their wedding night. And if you get there, then you will have an answer. You will clearly know if you are supposed to be a monastic or not. It's not an intellectual process. It's not you going through a list of questions. It's you learning who you are by prayer. And then you will know. See, there's also this perception of, so you become a monk or you become a nun, and then what do you do? I mean, what's your use? How are you relevant to the whole of Christianity? Or how are you useful to the church? How are you useful to the whole world? And I suppose this question comes from the way you see human interaction, human relationships. You could imagine that, you know, we interact by means of practical things. We do things. We help each other practically. Or, you know, the way our abbots or bishops or people in authority try to think that by imposing more discipline, for instance, or more rules and regulations, we will end up being a better society or a better church or a parish. Well, a monastic doesn't believe that. Not because you end up signing, I agree with what other monastics believe, but because that is what you experience, that is your intimate conviction. You don't change the world by rules, by creating more regulations. You change the world by changing yourself. You don't go on the outside, in the streets, feeding the poor and taking care of the sick and everything that Christ did command us to do. You do those things by going deep down. You do those things by... You see, there are these images which, you know, we can agree to or not. It's completely irrelevant, but they are useful for us now, of the church being a tree with several branches and two, three, four, 100, it really doesn't matter. A monastic will not look to the branches. That's essential. A monastic will try to go down in the trunk. A monastic will not try to work on the outside of the church, but to go down in its center and change its blood, so to say. And if you change that, then you change the composition of the whole church, of the whole tree. It's not, obviously nothing that, you know, lay people do is wrong. I don't want to say that in any way. And this is a talk about monasticism, so I'm talking about how a monastic sees things. When you go deep down in yourself, there is something in you that you can identify in everyone else. The same worries, the same fears, the same doubts, the same moments of losing your faith, the same horror in front of death and the idea of disappearing, and all these things are common to everyone. And if you heal them in yourself, then you can heal them in everyone else. So in that way, what a monastic does in his or her cell is completely relevant and vital to the whole humanity. Also remember that monk, comes from the Greek word monos, which basically means alone, one. When you pray in your own room, when you kneel down in front of your icon, you are being a monos yourself. So to some extent, you are being a monastic yourself. We all have this element of just feeling like wolves, of just wanting. I was going to Wenatchee, through those beautiful mountains. I told the driver, I just feel sometimes that I am a wolf, because all I want to do is get out of the car and keep running. Just keep running, but not running from something necessarily, but towards something. And that's actually important. I feel that when I spread myself in 10 or 100 practical things I'm trying to do to benefit others, I'm actually losing myself. I'm actually losing my center somehow. But when I run away from those things and I focus on prayer, then I find my center. And from that center, I can change the world as well. Not on the outside again, but deep down, like its blood. I believe in this idea of the world having blood. You know, St. Paul talked about the humanity or the church as being one body, and we are all various limbs. Well, I think monastics just change the chemical structure of the blood. And by doing that, you're actually changing the whole world. That to me is the essence of what a monastic is doing. When you run like a mad wolf, that was the other idea. You're also running from a temptation to end up understanding your own being, understanding who you are through the things of this world. This is something I thought about actually when I gave a talk in Arlington. You end up defining your own self through the realities of this world. And everything in this world is created. Everything. All beings, all objects, all concepts, all ideas, everything is created. So if you end up seeing yourself and defining yourself through a created world, then you will limit yourself to a created being. But a monastic knows that we carry the divine being. And so a monastic knows there must be something more to me than just being created the way we created this chair or, you know, a bunny outside. Or there's much more to me than being an economist, as I was, or being the father of 10 children, or the husband of, God willing, one wife. Or there's more to it. And so that when a monastic says no to all these things, you don't say no because you don't like the idea of a career. Many monastics are extremely talented people. We talked about Father Sofroni last night. He was a brilliant painter before he was a monastic. And actually, he said that overcoming that temptation of painting was his biggest fight. So it's not a matter of monks cannot do anything and therefore they go in a monastery. I could be doing many things, but you don't want, I mean, you don't believe as a monk that when Christ will finally see you, you will stay in front of him and just shake hands and say, my name is so and so and I am an economist. That's not who you are, that's what you do. And actually that's one of the tens of things you could have done. And you more or less ended up doing that thing because, you know, your parents made the choice for you, or you didn't have the money to go to the college you wanted to go, or you were born in a country where, you know, you couldn't have done anything else. So it's not really who you are. It's not even what you were created to do, although that's a nonsense in itself. A monastic says no to family and to his own will and to owning things, properties, because he and or she at least hopes that one day will end up understanding who they are through something else but this world. Through that relationship to Christ, which becomes the only thing that matters for a monk. If you take that away, a monk is no longer a monk. And in spring, when I started, these trips to fundraise for first for the land and now for the building of the monastery, in the springtime, I went through about 2 months of pure hell. Because when you travel, there's no framework around you. You've got no context. You lose everything that used to support you. You don't have your monastery, you don't have your monks around you, you don't have the daily services, you don't even have the silence to follow your services in your room because you don't have a room. I mean, people don't really understand what I'm doing. I am not one of those fundraisers that, you know, go and stay in a hotel and then they visit a parish and some extremely generous people give them thousands of dollars. I get $20 or $100, but I've raised over $100,000 doing that. What that means is that every day or every other day or 3 days, I move. I move to another place. I take my backpack and I go further. I don't know what I'm going to be next week. And you've got Father James and Korea to prove for that. I don't know where I'm going. I will just say yes to everything. I didn't know where Arlington was. When I got to Arlington, Father said, go to Snohomish. I went to Snohomish. Then he said, actually you said, go to Wenatchee. I went to Wenatchee. This is the way I travel. So when you do that as a monastic, there's no structure. There's no discipline. There's nothing. You can't afford. Today, I had this extraordinary luxury of being able to go through a migraine, which is an extraordinary luxury. A migraine, a horrible headache. Mm-hmm. You call them migraines, yes. Because usually these happen while I travel. I'm on a bus or on a train or somewhere. Today was actually wonderful because I had a bed to lie down and cover my head and, you know, go through it. So these 2 months at the beginning of the spring, that is what I was aiming, what I was getting to. They were hell, because I felt I've lost everything. There was nothing around me to define me as a monk anymore. But then I realized that being a monk is what I've just told you, having this relationship with Christ, this very private, personal relationship with Christ. And then it's almost as if when I do my backpack, I put Christ in it and I travel and he's with me. And everywhere I go, if I receive communion, or if I say my prayer, or if I say the Jesus prayer, or I do whatever I do, I know Christ is with me. And then everything changed. Because it was no longer about me having an environment or a behavior that defined me as a monastic. It was only about having Christ with me. And I can do that. I've only now learned that 10 years after being tonsured as a monk. You can do that anywhere. Absolutely anywhere, in any context, you can have Christ with you if you're naked in the middle of the street. You can still be a monk. So that, to me, is what monastics try, to find their own selves, to define themselves through Christ, not through a marriage, or not through parenthood, or not through having a career, or doing good deeds, although these are good things. But that's not a monastic's calling. And I think I had another idea. Yeah, somebody asked me, isn't that hard? It is hard. It is a fight, but one of the most beautiful, to me, bits of the Old Testament is Jacob's fight with that being, with that angel that the Holy Fathers understand as being God himself. As that fight where Jacob would not let go until God tells him his real name. And at the end of it, God says, "What's your name?" And he says, "I'm Jacob." And God says, "From now on, your name is Israel." At the end of this fight, you will find out who you are. It might not be who you think you are. You might look in the mirror and not recognize anything. You might be called by another name than the one you used to give yourself. But at least you know that is who you truly are. And I told people in Wenatchee this. This is one of the most intimate fears I've had, and actually one of the almost obsessions that got me into a monastery eventually, was this image of me just before death, looking back on my life and realizing that I have lived a life that is not my own. I have lived a life that was given to me by others, my parents or society or my ambitions or my fears or whatever else, but I've not lived my life. And the idea of looking back, no longer forward, because there's nothing in front of you anymore, looking back and realizing I should have been there, and instead of that, I chose to be here. And therefore, who I am today is not who God created me to be. That to me is hell. To go through life not being yourself, and to face death not being yourself, to die of a death that is not your own. That is one of the most horrible thoughts I have had for many, many, many years, and it actually contributed a great deal to me ending up becoming a monastic. You know, again, a monastery on an island. Why a monastery on an island? Why so far away? Why not in the middle of the cities? Why? And obviously these are not questions just for me, because the first monastics ran away from the world. That was the whole point. They went into the deserts. They went far, far away in the mountains. Well, funnily enough, I've always thought that monks and nuns are fundamentally missionaries, but not in the sense of going out and traveling the hills and the villages and talking to people in marketplaces, but in a more subtle, yet I believe more efficient way. It's not a conversion to a system of beliefs or an institution. It is a conversion to a state of sanctity, of holiness. Monastics don't try to convert people to orthodoxy in the sense of getting them to sign up to this particular institution. You try to convert people to a state of being holy, which you don't have yourself, but you know saints who have it, and you know elders living today who have it. And sometimes, through a mystery of God's, people get to taste that, even through people who are not holy themselves. And I believe that is the sort of mission work monastics are all called to do. Convert people to holiness. And I think the best example is again Saint Seraphim and his wonderful idea that I should become holy, and then thousands around me will also be saved and become holy. Because holiness, sanctity, is almost like a virus, like a disease. If you stay around a holy person, you become holy yourself. And this is what you see from the very first generations of monastics. That was the advice. If you want to be a saint, go and live with a saint. It's not about what you do or how you do it or for how long you do it or how much you eat or you don't eat or you sleep or you don't sleep. It has nothing to do with it. It is about being around holiness. And holiness, you should always recognize it outside yourself. Because if you end up seeing it in yourself, then you are deluded. That is the sure sign that you are deluded. If you see yourself as holy, if you see yourself as better or more spiritual than the ones around you, then look for help. Because that's the clear sign that you are deluded. And that's why obedience is so important in monasticism. And that's why hermits are never encouraged to live alone at the very beginning of their monastic lives. Saint Seraphim himself went for decades of living in a monastery and then close to the monastery and only then by himself far away in the woods. Saint Cuthbert, to whom our church is dedicated, he lived in a huge monastery, then he went to a smaller monastery, then he moved on an island that was very close to the main monastery, and only then, for the last years of his life, he went on foreign islands and lived completely isolated. Monks are supposed to convert the world to holiness, not to an institution. And I've always kept away from monasteries or monastics who reduce orthodoxy to a list of rules. The way you dress, if you cover your head or if you don't cover your head, if you are baptized or not baptized according to their own traditions, although we have very clear canons from the Holy Fathers going back to the very first centuries. All these exterior signs are just signs. We should convert the world not to an institution or a set of rules, but to a state of holiness, which, and this is the last line because it's vital, a state of holiness which we shouldn't recognize in ourselves, but always in someone else, preferably one's father confessor. That's it. If you have questions, please shoot. I've been told you want to know all sorts of strange things, like how did I become a monk, or when did I get back to the church, or all sorts of, I will answer them, but I cannot believe you actually want to know them, so I didn't get into that. So it's all up to you. Well, go ahead.
Wait, no.
Which of those?
How you became a monk? What was it like before then?
There was no before.
Please repeat the question.
No. How did I become a monk, and what was it like before that? And I am really an atypical type of a monastic, because there was no before. I feel like my life was outside what? I can't say outside the church, because I actually believe that the church, you know, is the whole humanity. I wasn't outside Christ, because I've always prayed and looked for him, but not according to any rules. But I clearly was not a practicing Christian, going to church and confessing and receiving communion and doing all the things we do, until I was 19. So that's one, chapter one of my life. And then when I discovered Christ in a different way, it was being a monastic from the beginning. It was either all or nothing. There was no sense. Although I was doing very well even for a 19-year-old. I was one of the best students in my class. I was already having all sorts of scholarship. I had a lovely girlfriend at the time, going clearly towards marriage, and you know, I had published several collections of poetry, so I also like to see myself as this bohemian type of person. I liked art. I really had a full life. And then in Moscow, it's because of art. Funnily, it's because of art, and that's why I always encourage people to see art. When I went to Moscow, that is one wonderful city. They have wonderful exhibitions and galleries and museums, and everything you want to see is there. But about 60, 70, 80% of what you see in all these places are icons. And not any icons, but the old, miracle-working, original icons. The ones that the very smart believers saw that the communists would just ruin. And they took them out of the churches after the Russian Communist Revolution, and they put them into museums. They got declared national treasures, and therefore they are saved, and they still exist today. And by that I mean the icon of the Mother of God in Vladimir, which you have in your church everywhere. You know, Rublev's Trinity, the other icons of Rublev, the other icons of Theophan the Greek, all these would have been lost forever without these very smart people who saw that the only salvation is to actually take them from the church and put them in museums. And now, you know, almost a century afterwards, these icons have become apostles, have become missionaries themselves. Because someone like me, I would never, ever have entered a church. Never. Clearly. It wasn't part of my life. I couldn't stand the institution. The whole idea of a clergy, of a hierarchy. That is what I never, ever liked. So I wouldn't have entered churches. But because of my love for art, I entered all these museums and all these galleries, and I got exposed to all this grace. And something in my heart must have changed. So that one day I was in the Tretyakov gallery, and I saw for, I don't know, the fourth time, fifth time, I always saw this sign saying, go towards the miracle icon of the Mother of God from Vladimir. And I never went, because I thought, it's just another icon. I've seen thousands, why would I want to see another one? And this is a special icon, which actually the communists have taken out of the gallery because of all the old babushkas that would go there to say their prayers, and therefore would embarrass, you know, the communist rulers. And they would actually take turns. They were very smart. They were allowed to sit in the same room, I think, for 10 or 15 minutes, and then they had to leave. So what they did is they had this gathering of old babushkas, and they took turns. One would go in for 10 minutes, and then she would leave, and her friend would come in and continue to, you know, say the prayer, so that they would pray constantly in front of the icon. So eventually they took the icon out and put it in a chapel nearby and connected the chapel through an underground system to the gallery. So just because it sounded so weird, I said, I must see this painting as well, this painting. And I went there and I saw it and I wanted to die, because everything, for the first time and only time to this day in my life, everything was perfect. I don't know how to express it. There was nothing I regretted of my life. There was not a sense of repentance. There was not a sense of hoping for something. Everything that could be was there. And if I could hold on to that moment, that would have been perfect for me. And then I went home to Bucharest and I spoke to my best friend, who is also a monastic today. He was a lawyer at the time. And then, although he was my best friend, I found out for the first time that he has a father confessor and that he goes to church. And his father confessor is my father confessor today. So actually I had no before. I wanted that all my life. And I knew every time I force myself to go back to that moment, I never can, but there is something of that taste that lingers on. But I know that family or career or even worry, human worry about managing things, that would prevent everything from happening. So it had to be monastic or not.
And how did you go from, how did you respond to this experience?
How did I respond to this experience? I went to this priest extremely reluctantly, because, you know, just another priest, kind of fat, center of Bucharest, surrounded by people who clearly just adored him. So he had all the misqualifications for someone like me. And then I heard him. There is a moment when, at least in the Romanian tradition, I don't know about the other traditions, but there is this moment in the Divine Liturgy when the priest can, if he so chooses, sing. There is a song, I Shall Love You, Lord, just before you say the creed, the symbol of faith. And when he sang that song, I had something of the same feeling I had in front of that icon. And I realized this man, it's so strange. I've made a choice twice in my life to trust someone else more than I trust myself. And that was huge for someone as proud as I was and still am. To first this friend of mine, basically my first confession, my full confession, happened to him, in front of him, not a priest. And then he had the wisdom to say, I cannot help you, you need to see a priest. And then I decided in that moment, I will trust him more than my own instincts and my own experience, and I will go and see a priest. And then, when I met that priest, who is now my father confessor, I made the same choice. And for the first years of my life, many of the things he asked of me went against what I believed to be true or useful. But I did it. Even going to that particular monastery where I went in Moldavia, I had never been there before. I had never seen that monastery. The first time I set foot in that monastery was when I actually went to be there, to be ordained and tonsured there, just because he said so. There comes a moment in your life when, if you really are honest, you realize you cannot be your own escape. You cannot get out of yourself. You need someone else to just grab you, like in those science fiction movies, you know, a hand to go in you and get you out of yourself. Because otherwise, it's a dead end. And that was one of the two moments I've done that, when I met my father confessor. And I'm thankful to this day for having done that. And there were so many temptations to break us apart, so many temptations, from the most ridiculous things, like, you know, him being fat, which I discovered afterwards is because he's diabetic. So he's really struggling with that, and that's what makes him kind of inflate and deflate irregularly. To deeper things, I learned to shut up. I learned not to always express my point of view. I learned that there is another point of view that could be just as valuable as mine. I learned to just submit to someone else's will. And I learned that no matter how badly things go, he will always be there. It doesn't matter what I do. He will always be there. And he will always do everything in his power to help me. If he gives me poison, spiritually speaking, then I'll take it, because I know he knows me better than I know myself. I have the same information about myself, but I don't have the same objective view from the outside that he does. And that's why it's extremely important to have a father confessor. And you, I mean, in my case, again, I really am an atypical case. I feel God has made such huge sacrifices for me by just showing everything. It all became clear to me in one instant what I need to do with my life. And then just showing me the first priest I was sent to was perfect for me. Perfect. I've got 10 years of monasticism now behind me. I've met probably thousands of priests, and I would not change my father confessor. Although he is a lay priest, he's not a monastic. I wouldn't change it. It was right from the very beginning. But for most people, the most, you know, the best advice is to tempt, really tempt, your spiritual father. Saint John of the Ladder actually says that. Try him out. Try him out. Be extremely careful, because then when you give yourself to him, you can't look back. So be very careful before you do that, that he is the right person. Because then you no longer know. I mean, is he a bad person? This is a thought you might have 4 years later. Is his advice actually bad? You cannot ask yourself that. You have to trust that God is speaking to you through him. You have to trust that despite your, you know, in spite of your feelings, intuitions, instincts, experience, everything you are, you have to be able to trust that the Holy Spirit speaks through him. And again, you have to trust him more than yourself. Yeah.
So, Father, you're very educated, and I was wondering if somebody wanted to become or made the choice to become a monastic later on in life, would you say that the education that they might have before that would be a drawback or a benefit when they became a monastic?
Do I need to repeat that? It depends from person to person. I mean, I've seen this question actually asked many times, and you know, various people say, the very large majority would say that education is a drawback, and that the sooner you go into a monastery, the better. My experience has been that you need to go in a monastery when God calls you, that very moment. Not sooner, not later. If your father confessor for any reason tests you, so kind of postpones it for a while, then follow his advice. Obeying to him, you're basically already behaving like a monk. You're doing obedience in a way a normal lay person wouldn't. You are basically asking him to go through a life-changing experience. And he says, no, wait for a year or 3 years, as my father confessor asked me. Can you imagine someone going to a father confessor and saying, I want to get married? And he's saying, no, wait for 3 years. That would never happen. Because that sort of demand you only ask of someone who wants to become a monastic. And that is already a test. If you fail that, you're not monastic material. If you put your head down and you just survive those years, then you can bet that once you get in the monastery, you'll get a reward for that. So that's in connection to time. I don't believe there's, you know, just go when you're being called and when you got your father confessor's blessing. That's the end of it. And education, it only benefited me. But again, that's my own private experience. I am someone who believes that you should just be who you are. If you feel that education helps you make sense of yourself and the world around you and God, then go as far as you can. Why not? I mean, if God put that gift in you, why would you waste it? And then also keep in mind, education doesn't always have to be before you become a monk. I have a bachelor degree and a master degree before I was tonsured, before I got into a monastery. And then I have a second bachelor degree, a PhD degree, and I'll go to Oxford next year. So I've done more in terms of education after being tonsured than before. And it's the same with art. Everybody is afraid of art in the Orthodox Church because art is troubling. Art is, you know, you can't define it. You see paintings and you don't get them. What are they? What did he mean? What is it? Is it a human being? Is it a goat? Is it, what is it? But actually, if you take everything that doesn't make sense of our lives and you only keep the things that are logical, then God has no place in your life. Because God doesn't make sense. God is not logical. God is always a metaphor, so to say. God is always abstract, so to say. I have this, perhaps the family I feel most comfortable with in the UK, an English family. I have met them while studying there before I went to the monastery. And they have three wonderful children, all of them converted to Orthodoxy except the husband, but I have my plan. and he knows it, so he can see this. There was a moment when I remember playing with the little boy in the family, and I told him something silly. I mean, we Romanians, we like fairy tales where everything, I mean, nothing makes sense. Pigs fly just because they do, and they talk just because. And I was just developing such a fairy tale. And then this extremely dear friend of mine, the mother of the little boy, came to me and said, oh, don't say that anymore. Or if you say that the cat or the pig is flying around, explain how it's flying around. It has a balloon attached to it, or it just ate a balloon, or there must be an explanation because cats and pigs don't fly. And it made sense on the moment, and I thought, oh, that's a very different way of raising somebody up. But then, as I was on my train back to Durham, London to Durham, it felt so wrong. It felt so wrong, because if you teach your children that only things that are logical, or you can prove, you can touch, are real, then how do you expect them to believe in Christ later on? How do you expect them to believe that, you know, God became man, and he died, God died, and then that God-man came back to life, and now he's in heavens? That makes no sense. So if you teach your mind to only believe logical, practical things, I think you actually, that is a handicap, which you can actually heal. And one of the most useful pills, medicine, to heal that, in my case, has been art. Things that make absolutely no sense. If you teach your heart and your mind to just react to beauty, then you're safer than to just reacting to logical things. Yeah. Are we done? Yes, please.
In a marriage, how do husband and wife imitate? You talk about this obedience to a spiritual father, and then you talk about in marriage you have a husband and wife with two different perspectives, two different orientations, two different ways of behaving and thinking. How does that blend together in creating an experience of love? Of holiness.
Well, first of all, why would you ask a monastic? So that's in all honesty, I will answer because I got used to answering anything. But why would you seek advice from a monastic? Why would you not seek advice on that topic from a married priest? I am a monastic. And I do believe that Orthodoxy suffers from a sort of semi-idolatry, but it's such a harsh way of expressing it. We give too much credit to one way of living Christianity. A monastic is someone who chose a different life than your own. Your state, the state of holiness or perfection that is perfectly available to you, is in no way below that is, you know, to me. When we are in Christ's kingdom, we shall be the same. We shall be glorified with the same glory. It's just a matter of calling and following your own path. And why would I get this as a father confessor? Because my metropolitan, whom I dearly love, that was towards him, asked me to function as a father confessor for more than 4 years. And people come and ask me things like this, or even things that have to do with their intimate lives. You know, how, or how many times, or when, or where, or... First of all, I don't want to think about it. I don't want to think about it. Just, I don't want to think about it. And secondly, I don't know. I can give you answers from books, but you can read the same books. And the problem even with those books is that 90% of them are written by other monastics. So then you end up with rules that say that, you know, a man and a wife should never have relations during, I don't know, when they're fasting. Why? Why? I'm a monastic and I don't understand. If marriage is a sacrament, then does that sacrament become sinful or a source for sin during fasting? Well, in that case, I'd better not fast, because I'm doing a blasphemy against the sacrament. I mean, it makes no sense to me how we can sit in front of the altar, we go through a marriage service, we believe it is a sacrament, and mind you, the service by which monastics are tonsured is not recognized as a sacrament. But marriage is. So that is a sacrament, the same way confession is a sacrament, baptism is a sacrament, and so on. But suddenly we have these black holes, black periods, when the sacrament becomes a source for sin. How? I mean, honestly, how? I've read my eyes out and I haven't found one explanation. And all the authors who say that these sort of things are either monastics or have confessed that are monastics. I don't understand. It's like saying that we should never confess when we fast, because confession during fast is a sin. You can confess outside the fast, that's fine. It goes back to being a sacrament, but not during the fast. So I'm not only a monastic and therefore the bad person to answer to your question, I'm also a very atypical monastic that doesn't like the answers monastics give to these questions. Obedience. Recently, about 2 months ago, I think, in August, I was part of a group. In England, there's this fellowship between the Orthodox Church and the Anglican Church called the Fellowship of St. Sergius and St. Alban. And I went to their meeting, their conference this year, and then we took a brief pilgrimage to visit Essex, the monastery in Essex, founded by Father Sofroni. And Mother Magdalene addressed us with a very short but, as usual, extremely dense talk. And she said, do you know how you recognize when you see several nuns outside, or even two nuns outside, do you know to distinguish, to recognize which is the one who's been in the monastery longer than the other one? Because you can't by their age. Some people go into monasteries in their 50s, 60s, or even older. Others go in their 20s. So a 40-year-old could be in a monastery for 20 years, and a 60-year-old could be in a monastery for 2 days. Do you know what's the sure sign you can distinguish between someone who's been a monastic for 20 years and one who's been for 2 days? The older one, the more experienced one, is the one who obeys to the other. It's not the way you would expect it. It's not the more experienced one who asks the other ones to do things and the other ones obey. That's how it should be, but it never is. It's the other way around. It's the more experienced ones. It's the more spiritual ones. It's the holier ones who actually obey to the weaker ones until they also grow and understand what benefit it is in obedience and what benefit it is in not following your own will. So I suppose it doesn't answer your question, but it is the sort of advice I imagine could be very useful in the relationship between a husband and a wife. Always the wiser one will obey. And then if you don't, if God gives you children, you'll end up obeying them anyway. There's no escape from that. I've seen that in so, so many families, in these little creatures. Who invented them? That was such a bad invention. They end up taking over, and they'll humble you, and they'll teach you everything about obedience. So, we have this elder in Romania, Elder Cleopa, who passed away. Actually, his life is published in English, in America as well. A beautiful elder. And he used to say as a joke, when other men would ask him, why did you become a monk? He said, out of pride. Because I'd rather obey to another man than to another woman, than to a woman. So, but that was a joke. Yeah. Yes,
Sarah, please. Could you talk more about your monastery and, you know, where, you know, how many monks will be there, or?
The monastery in the Hebrides, you mean, the monastery on Mal?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, first of all, it will be a women's monastery, mm-hmm. not a men's monastery. Mm-hmm. And I've already explained why we made that choice. It's a matter of being friendly to the people around us. I don't believe that having a men's monastery, you know, taking several men dressed in black with beards on an island who have never seen something like this, will do any benefit for anyone. We will always be a ghetto, and nobody will ever, you know, integrate us in the life of the island. But women are more sociable and friendly and humane somehow, you know. So that's why we opted to have a women's monastery. I'm also very bad at exercising authority. So if that were a men's monastery, I would have to either name someone else as an abbot, and I'm afraid, or just found a monastery and I would have to leave somewhere else. I can't boss people around. Mm-hmm. I can, I've done it, but then I go back to my room and I just hate myself. Mm-hmm. Even though I was right, even though I was the one in authority, even though I know how they benefit from me doing it, if I've raised my voice, I just hate my guts. So that's why it will be a women's monastery. It will also be English speaking for more or less the same reasons. I don't believe a Greek speaking, Russian speaking, Romanian speaking monastery on an island in the Atlantic will help anyone. I mean, nobody speaks those languages, not even the sharks around. So. You need to address people in their language. And what I hope for is that it will attract people from the English-speaking languages, such as the UK, the US, Australia, Canada, who feel this calling to become monastics. I cannot imagine the drama and the pain that someone feeling a vocation to become a monastic goes through when they realize there isn't such a monastery in their own countries. Mm-hmm. And it's unfair. It's just unfair. Because I've met people here, many people, and I've met many people in the UK who have a vocation for the monastic life and who have acknowledged that. They know it. They want it. And then there's nowhere to go. The only monastery in the UK that is a proper monastery is Essex. So if for any reason you don't want to go to Essex, or if Essex for any reason won't take you, which might happen as well, you've got no option. You have to come back to the States, where most of the monasteries, well, are non-English speaking, or go to Greece or Russia or somewhere. So that's what this monastery is in the Hebrides. This used to be the Orthodox Church of the West in the first millennium. Why can't it be what it once used to be? especially when we have someone like, say, Columba, saying that it will once be what it used to be. I have this vision of a British monastery, not English, not Scottish, just British. And that's why calling it Celtic is so useful, because it's like going again down in a trunk rather than the tree and the branches. And actually that's why I say half a lie everywhere I go. This church is called Kilninian, the church we own. And that means the church of Ninian, because it was dedicated to Saint Ninian. But Saint Ninian is the church of Scotland, and I want this to be a monastery for the UK. So when I came from Durham, where I fell in love completely with Saint Cuthbert, I added him up. And I tell everyone that we preserve the ancient dedication of the church, Saint Cuthbert and Ninian, but that's only half true. But I want an English saint, and I want a Scottish saint. Mm-hmm. And I want to pray, I want them to bless that place and that country. I'm very grateful to that country in many ways. Done? Please.
On St. Cuthbert, would there be any way to translate his relics there ultimately?
I doubt it very seriously. They are now in the cathedral in Durham. And if you think that they've actually built that cathedral, which, mind you, is still standing 1,000 years afterwards, mm-hmm. the same building, 1,000 years is still standing, and they built that cathedral for his relics. I kind of doubt they will give us his relics. I will ask, but there are bits and pieces of relics of St. Cuthbert around, and I pray to God we will have some of those. But I don't worry about that. I mean, St. Cuthbert is here. I honestly believe St. Cuthbert is here now. So, done? Please.
I asked you last night about prayer
to
saints. And forgive me, but I'm new to Orthodoxy. We were baptized 2 years ago. And so I still retain a lot of my Protestant thoughts. And I don't have trouble with the saints or praying to saints. On the contrary, I've been very pleasantly surprised at how drawn to certain saints I've mm-hmm. been. It's something I've never experienced in my whole life. But I would like to learn more. I would like to learn, like even what you just said about St. Cuthbert being here. When I pray, when I go about my daily doings, how should I be thinking about the saints, and how should I be with them in a way? And I don't really know how to even really form a question. I think you get what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, you see, for me, this trip also meant the first serious encounter with people coming from the Protestant worlds, because there are many of them. And the questions themselves are strange to me. I'm saying that as an observation, nothing else. You see, it's almost like you are looking for an explanation. I never received an explanation. Nobody ever, when I hear about catechisms, it's very strange to me. I don't know what's happening there. I would actually want to be a fly in one room to see what it's being said. Because I believe in things you live, things you do that happen to you, things you go and practice, not things that are being taught to you. Because the same way I can explain that, I don't know, the world is round, somebody could come after me and explain that the world is flat, or, you know, a cube or something. And then it's all down to how charismatic that person is, which is very dangerous. The way I learned things, and that's why I always advise people, is by trying them out. I mean, I've learned to love saints, particular saints, because as you said, at various points in my life, I felt extremely attracted to some of them. And I mean, it's the same things I keep praying for even to this day. Saint Nicholas, Saint Seraphim, they're always the first ones. Always the first ones. I switch them from time to time because I don't know if they're upset that the other one is in front of the other one. And I go through, and then I say no, because Saint Seraphim is a monk and Saint Nicholas is a bishop. He should be first, but my name is Seraphim. And I suppose this is one way you can carry them with you, a stupid way, but one way of doing it. Just pray to them. I've read somewhere, I don't remember where, but my memory is not that good, but I've read somewhere that we don't choose our saints. It is the saints who choose us. It is the saints, some saints, who just choose us, and then they take care of us our whole lives. Just follow that through. But follow it like a monk, all or nothing. I mean, if I love Saint Nicholas, and there are reasons for me loving Saint Nicholas, then when I had a chance to create a mission in Newcastle, in England, I dedicated it to Saint Nicholas. When I had a chance to go to Bari in the south of Italy, where his relics are, I went. Just before I went to the monastery in 2004, I made two pilgrimages, one to Bari, one to Divevo, where the relics of Saint Seraphim are. So I went to them, I said, okay, I'm doing this, be with me, because otherwise it's going to be a mess. And then I went to the monastery. If you check my luggage, I've got two acathists with me, Seraphim and Nicholas. I've got two tiny bits of relics with me, always, all the time. I have them now with me, Seraphim and Nicholas. I went to Divevo, and I went through asking my abbot's blessing, my bishop's blessing, the blessing of the abbess at the monastery in Divevo, the blessing of the bishop in Divevo, and then they gave me this little scrap of Saint Seraphim's relic. I was in the altar when they gave it to me. I've seen them taking it. So do it all the way. And you won't need to explain to yourself or to anyone else why you're praying to saints. You're doing it because by doing it, they're there. I don't know how to explain it. It's like you'd ask me to tell you why I love my mother. I don't know. She just happened to be around. She's been very useful. And I love her because she's been useful and around. But I don't have a system. Probably other people would be extremely convincing on an intellectual level. But because I don't believe in that, I never have. Despite, you know, all the diplomas and things like that, I won't even try. Do it, and you'll just know it. And when you know it, it doesn't matter who can. You can have an army of, you know, pastors in front of you arguing against praying to saints, because yes, it makes sense. But how do you explain that it actually works? That's how it is. I mean, I can have a million people explaining to me that my mom is a horrible person. She might be. But she still feeds me. I'm 34, and when I go home, she still feeds me. She washes my clothes. She makes my bed. She does everything for me. So she might be horrible, but it works for me. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Try to stay away. Try to just practice it. Stay away from things in your mind.
I feel like I live experientially like that, but I'm surrounded by people who are very rational and logical. So I feel like I know things before I have a definition for them. But then I feel like gathering the definition helps me feel more confident in the world around me or the people that I relate to on a daily basis. So I know it, like you're saying.
Yeah.
I feel that I know.
Then
it.
Just use them. Use them in the sense of those bad people around you. Just go down, honestly, get on your knees and pray and change them. Pray like a monk, change his blood. Honestly, we have to believe these things. The same God who created our hearts can change them. It's the same power, the same God, the same power that he had when he created the world, or when he became incarnate, when he resurrected, it's the same power. He can do everything. And get an army of saints behind you, and he has no chance. It's as simple as that. I mean.
Thank you. All right.
Forgive me, but... Okay? I think we're done. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for that.
It's been such a blessing for us all.